Yes, children, good morning. Today again we're going to see a class, and that class is on ray optics. And in this pandemic situation, I know you people are staying at home and taking all sorts of precaution. So let us start today's class. That is on the topic ray optics. And it is presented by Seema Nigam, PGT Physics, Kendriya Vidyalaya, number 1, Armapur, Kanpur. Inspirational thought for today is, success is walking from failure to failure with no loss of enthusiasm. It was given by Winston. So we should never lose our faith. We should keep on trying. Previous knowledge, we learnt about electromagnetic waves, its properties, that they are transverse in nature and they travel with speed of light, they can be reflected and refracted. Now, introduction. How do we introduce the chapter? Today we will learn about visible rays, that is light. Light is an electromagnetic wave. It has both wave nature and particle nature. And in this chapter, we will learn about ray optics. Refraction of light. You can see in general refraction, there are two medias of refractive index N1 and N2. The one that is coming here is the incident ray, and the one that is going in the another medium is the refracted ray. Since it is a denser medium, it bends towards the normal and partially it is getting reflected. And then comes the laws of reflection, refraction, that is incident ray, refracted ray and the normal all lie in the same medium. And we know the Snell's law, that is sin I upon sin R is equal to N, that is the refractive index of the medium. Now coming to refraction through a glass slab. When we see the refraction through the glass slab, we have the glass slab, and when the ray of light is incident and makes an angle theta 1, that is the angle of incidence, then it gets refracted towards the normal, bends towards the normal. Angle of refraction is theta 2, and again it goes from denser to rarer medium, it bends away from the normal, and this angle is theta 3. So angle of incidence, angle of refraction and angle of emergence. Total internal reflection. So total internal reflection is the phenomenon in which when a light goes from denser to rarer medium at an angle greater than critical angle, it gets totally internally reflected. What is the condition? The ray should be incident from denser to rarer medium. The angle of incidence should be greater than the critical angle. And critical angle is that angle in which the refracted angle is 90 degrees. Small video. A semicircular transparent glass is taken, light is being incident on the glass normally first, and then the angle of incidence is increased, thereby angle of refraction takes place. As we go on increasing, angle is being increased. So this will be the angle of incidence from the normal. Then at a particular angle, see, it's going to just become 90 degrees. That's all. And a little bit more than that, it gets internally reflected. So this is the position where it is showing the total internal reflection, and if we go on further increasing, the total, it gets totally internally reflected, the angle of incidence becomes equal to the angle of reflection. Thus we can see the total internal reflection through the small video. You can see with the help of another experiment where we are making the laser beam of light through the pen to pass through glass of water, and we can see it gets totally internally reflected. The beam is getting reflected. Now diagram, ray diagram, we can see when it was being passed through the normal, it goes straight, and if we increase the angle, it gets refracted. Further increasing, it gets refracted to 90 degrees, that angle is critical angle, and after that when we increase, it gets totally internally reflected. Same thing you can see here also, and Snell's law, N1 sin theta 1 is equal to N2 sin theta 2. Theta 1 and theta 2 is present here. It is refracted angle and the incident angle, and at that particular angle when it becomes 90 degrees, the critical angle. So here theta I is nothing but theta C, and when theta I is greater than theta C, it gets totally internally reflected. This is how we will find out the relationship between the refractive index and the critical angle. We know mu is equal to sin I upon sin R. So here sin of angle of incidence between ray in air and normal, that is sin I. So air is here. That is this R portion where refraction technique, that is the rarer medium. So the angle that is in the rarer medium is now sin 90, and that in the denser medium is sin IC or sin of the critical angle. So sin 90 is 1. So we see mu is equal to 1 by sin IC. That is mu is inversely proportional to sin of the critical angle. Now what are the applications of TIR? It shows brilliance in diamond. Shining of diamond is one of the application of total internal reflection. Secondly, we can see the mirage. What is mirage? It is optical illusion of water absorbed in deserts on hot summer days. We can see in the desert, what we see here is when the ray of light is incident from the tree on the layer, it passes from denser, that is the air that is above the earth, much above is bit cold since it is denser, then the air just above the earth, which is it is hot, that is a rarer. So ray of light is incident from denser to rarer, hence it gets totally internally reflected, reaches the man's eye. So the man sees straight like this, and he sees the image here. So for him it looks as if there is water here. So this total internal reflection, mirage. Similarly, we have the totally reflecting prisms. In totally reflecting prism, there are two types of prisms. One is deviated through 180 degrees, another one is deviated through 90 degrees. Here we can see the deviation is in such a way that the object which was going upwards now seems to be inverted. So there is a deviation of 180 degrees. This is 180 degree deviating prisms. There is a deviation of 180 degrees. So when the ray of light is incident, it gets totally internally reflected here. At this point, it is being totally internally reflected. Similarly, here in this prism, the ray, the object is like this, and when it gets reflected totally internally, the object comes out to be like this. So there is a deviation of 90 degrees. So this is a 90 degree deviating prism. So this totally reflecting prisms are of two types. So this we can see is also one of the applications of this total internal reflection, which we can see in the prisms, how we can deviate an object through 180 degree and see it, and or through 90 degree we can deviate and see. Another application is the optical fibers, which is used in communication. Here also there is total internal reflection, light gets multiple total internal reflection, and we can see the light entering from one end and comes out through the another end. Here the cladding is done in such a way that internal portion is of denser medium, and external portion that is being cladded is of rarer medium, and thus it gets totally internally reflected. Now comes the refraction through convex spherical surface. So when we are learning this refraction through convex spherical surface, what we will see is how does it happen. Here we are keeping, this is a convex spherical surface, object is kept in the rarer medium, image is formed in the denser medium. This is the incident ray. This is the refracted ray. And when we draw the normal and we write the angle alpha, beta, alpha is the angle subtended by the object, beta is the angle subtended by the image, and gamma is the angle subtended by the center of curvature. What do we see? If we take the triangles, two triangles, one triangle is OAC, then we can see the exterior angle I is equal to in sum of the two interior angles alpha and beta. So I is equal to alpha plus beta. Similarly, if we take another triangle ACI, the exterior angle gamma is equal to sum of the two interior angles R and beta. So R plus beta. So when we can write R in terms of gamma and beta, it becomes like this. Then we write tan alpha, it is MA upon MO, tan beta, it is MA upon MI, tan gamma, it is MA upon MC. And then we use a Snell's law, is mu 2 upon mu 1. And if angle is very small, it is I by R. Is equal to mu 2 upon mu 1, or mu 1 into I is equal to mu 2 into R. And we substitute the value of I here, which is sum of this alpha and beta, and R here, which is sum of this gamma minus beta. Substitute all that values, and when we derive it, we get the formula minus of mu 1 upon u plus of mu 2 upon v is equal to mu 2 minus mu 1 upon R. Now, when the object is kept in the denser medium and image is formed in the rarer medium, then again we derive the same way and we get the formula. Now it is a bit different. Now it is mu 2 upon u, because object is kept in a denser medium and the refractive index of denser medium is mu 2, of the rarer medium is mu 1. So it is minus of mu 2 upon u plus of mu 1 upon v is equal to mu 1 minus mu 2 upon R. So this becomes, the formula is a bit different. Mu 1 and mu 2 gets interchanged. There it was mu 2 minus mu 1, now it is mu 1 minus mu 2. Similarly, refraction of convex surface from denser medium to rarer medium, the image is virtual, the formula comes out to be the same as the first one, minus mu 2 upon u plus mu 1 upon v is equal to mu 1 minus mu 2 upon R. These two formulas are nearly the same. And same formula you can see when refraction is being done in the concave surface. The ray diagram in that respect is here. Object is giving a virtual image. See, object is here, it gets incident, and the same when it is being produced, image is formed here. So in the virtual image, the formula is same, minus of mu 1 upon u plus mu 2 upon v is equal to mu 2 minus mu 1 upon R. And through concave spherical surface also, same formula. Now this is, I just now seen. Now going further, the lens maker formula. So what is this lens maker's formula? First of all, let us see the ray diagram of a lens maker. In this, what happens? We are taking double convex lens. So it is being convex from both the sides. And first one surface, if we take, the image is formed here, I1. And when we take the refraction to second surface, that is this surface, this gets further bent and it is formed at I. So this is an intermediate image, I1. So we can derive the formula, that is the lens maker's formula. That is, when we take it, so this is the final image formed here. This is the intermediate image here. So we use both the formulas. Just now we learned about that. In place of mu, here n is written. So we know from the first surface, the formula is mu 2 upon v1. The intermediate image distance be v1, here this one. So it is mu 2 upon v1 minus mu 1 upon u is equal to mu 2 minus mu 1 upon r1, where r1 is the radius of curvature on the right hand side and R2 is the radius of curvature on the left hand side. So R2 is negative. So the formula comes out to be this: from the first surface, second surface, the formula comes out to be N1 upon V minus N2 upon V1. V is the final image. V1 is now the object, which is the which acts like an object for the second surface. And then it is R1 N1 minus N2 upon R2. Now when we add both, what do we get? We'll see that N2 upon V1 and N2 upon V1 gets cancelled, and we get N1 upon V minus N1 upon U is equal to n2 minus n1 into 1 by r1 minus 1 by r2. And when we divide the whole equation by n1, it becomes 1 by v minus 1 by u. And n2 upon n1 is just n, that is the refractive index, minus 1 into 1 by r1 minus 1 by r2. Further, we replace 1 by v minus 1 by u with 1 by f. So 1 by f is equal to n mu minus 1, 1 by r1 minus 1 by r2. Now we are going to see the convex lens ray diagram. Of course, a convex lens, the rays that is coming are parallel and they get converged at the focus. We have learned these images in our lower classes. So this also we have been seeing how we will derive the lens equation. This is the ray diagram. When the object is kept between the center of curvature and the focus, we get the real and inverted image. And when we solve by taking the two triangles and taking the ratio of the heights, putting the sign conventions u, v, f, we get the formula as 1 by f is equal to 1 by v minus 1 by u. This is the lens equation. And next comes the magnification, linear magnification, that is height of the image upon height of the object. Also it can be written as what? Height of image distance upon object distance. And we know image distance is negative, object distance is positive. Similarly, height of the image is negative, height of the image is positive. So we get minus sign. Now when the two lenses are being combined, so combination of thin lenses, when they are being combined, you can see the image gets further converged if two convex lenses are there. What will be the formula for this? We can see the formula. Combination of lens, the formula is 1 by f is equal to, the reciprocals get added up. 1 by f is equal to 1 by f1 plus 1 by f2. Because if they are convex lens, f is positive. If one is concave, the f becomes negative. And of course, we know 1 by f is power. So power is also gets added up, p1 plus p2. Dispersion of light. What is dispersion of light? Splitting of white light into seven colors, that is called as dispersion. And we can see the dispersion phenomena in prism. When white light is being passed, it gets split up into seven colors from violet to red. Violet, indigo, blue, green, yellow, orange, red. Now, ray diagram of a prism. You can see the ray diagram of prism. What are the rays? Main ray is this red one. That is the incident ray, PQ, the refracted ray here, EF, and the emergent ray, FS. These are the two main rays, the three main rays. And the angle of incidence, angle of refraction here. This is the angle of refraction here. This is the angle of refraction. And this is the angle of emergence. And this line that goes is the incident ray. And this line that is bending is the deviated ray. So the angle between the incident and the deviated ray gives us the angle of deviation given by D. And of course, this is the angle of the prism. These are the normals that is being drawn perpendicular to the surface. Now, we can derive the refractive index of a prism. What we are seeing is A plus R is equal to 180 degrees. If we take the triangle, just the of the prism, and we can see the two refractions, one refraction from I is R1, another refraction from E was R2. So we see that R1 plus R2 plus R is 180 degrees, and when we compare both, we say A is equal to R1 plus R2. So this is main thing, A is equal to R1 plus R2. And the relationship between the between A and del is I plus E is equal to A plus del. This we will get when we solve this equation. But taking the exterior angle is equal to sum of the two interior angles, we can solve this. And we get I plus E is equal to A plus del. So these are the two main things which you have to keep in mind. And when we go further, at minimum deviation position, angle I becomes equal to angle E. So I plus E was equal to A plus del. Now I becomes equal to E, it means 2I is equal to A plus del. Now del is del M, that is the minimum deviation position. Therefore I becomes equal to A plus del M by 2. Now we know mu is equal to sin I upon sin R. So here mu is equal to sin e upon sin r2. And when I is equal to a, r1 becomes equal to r2. When r1 becomes equal to r2, a becomes equal to 2r. Because a was r1 plus r2, a becomes equal to 2r1 or 2r2, whatever you write, becomes 2r, or r becomes equal to a by 2. Now we know mu is equal to sin I upon sin r. In place of I, we write a plus del m by 2. In place of r, we write a by 2. So the refractive index of the prism is mu is equal to sin a plus del m by 2 sin a by 2. So thank you, today's class.